Hey everybody, we're going to do another Bible study. We're going to read from 1st and 2nd Corinthians. I was reading this earlier and I said, wow, I got to do a Bible study on that because there's some really good information there. And I'm going to also give you some free things here, a free audio Bible. And you take a look at the website there, right there where it says Galatians 3:26, shakanow.net. When you go there, you can click any of these links here, and there's all types of free things you can get, okay? Now, also, what you can do is you go up here where it says More, and just kind of hold your mouse there. And then, what you can do is scroll down here and get a lot of good things there, free books, free audiobooks, and things like that. Another thing, too, is the site's so big, we've added so much stuff, sometimes I get lost in it too. Free audio Bible right here, this is great. And then also, if you want some free games, free software programs that'll speed up your computer, free antivirus programs, things like that, click there. So let's get started, and I hope you enjoy the Bible study. Now, as you guys know, I used to be an atheist, and I became a Christian. And one of the things that a lot of people will say in the atheist community is they'll say, well, the Bible's a book of fairy tales. Now, that's obviously not true, but I think that it might be good that maybe the atheist keeps saying that, and I'm going to tell you why. Even though that actually helps Christianity when they say it's a book of fairy tales, I'm going to tell you why. But it hurts atheism. That's why I say, you know, I don't really worry if they are saying that, because sooner or later someone's actually going to read the Bible if they haven't read it yet. And they're going to see that it's not a book of fairy tales. It has nothing to do with that. A lot of it is biography, letters written back and forth, history. There's even beautiful poetry and songs and things like that. So you're going to see information almost like a biography on how the disciples struggled as they were being persecuted for Christ. So when the critics of the Bible go around saying it's a book of fairy tales, it really hurts their cause, because when you get an atheist like I was that actually reads it, and I'm going to read you some of this right now, you realize, wow, these are actual letters that were sent back and forth of the first Christians. These aren't fairy tales. These are people that really believe that Jesus died and rose from the dead. And it hurts the cause of atheism, for example. I remember I called into a radio show, and there were four atheists there, and I took on four atheists, and I asked them to provide some proof and evidence that would show atheism was accurate and correct. And the guy was very ignorant. He said that, well, the Bible's just a book of fairy tales. And it was like, it was ridiculous. And then they were not able to give me any arguments for why atheism is true. And finally, the guy just threw up his hands. And matter of fact, I'm going to put that link below this video of my actual column to the atheist show. And, well, actually, I'll show you where you can get it. Check this out. When you go to shakanow.net, click videos, okay? Just click videos here, and you're going to see it there. My call into an atheist radio show where the atheist host, finally, after they cannot prove that atheism is accurate and correct, they say, they admit it. You'll hear them say it. Well, the only thing they have is their say-so, which is just their opinion. And of course, as Christians, we have so many arguments for God's existence. You know, we have prophecy, the history of Jesus Christ, the ontological argument, the transcendental argument, the teleological argument. We have experiential reality. We have the argument from objective morality. And so you can stick that in your pipe and smoke it, atheist. But when you guys, when I called into the show and they're like, well, you know, their evidence is that they say so. Well, la-ti-da, that ain't good enough. I need proof and evidence. And this is why I became a Christian, because it offers proof and evidence. Atheism is really all about blind faith, and I just don't have enough blind faith to be an atheist. And I don't even call it atheism. I like to call it faithism. And there's certainly nothing wrong with having faith in something that is rational and logical and has proof and evidence, like Christianity. But to have faith in something that has no logical foundation and something like atheism that is intellectually, spiritually, and morally bankrupt is just not rational to be an atheist. If someone's an atheist, they're just not thinking rational. So let's get to the Bible study. And don't forget, go to shotgunnow.net, see right here on the top right, and click videos, and I'll put the video there. It's going to be titled Atheist Can't Prove Atheism. That's what I'll call it. And you'll see the video there. It's my entire call into the radio show. And listen closely how all four of them fall down like pins in a bowling alley. They're not able to provide proof and evidence that atheism is accurate or correct, because it's not atheism, it's faithism. All right, let's get started. Listen to this. This is excellent. This is Paul, okay? Paul was killing the Christians, arresting them, persecuting them, because he was very zealous for his religion. And then he says that he has a... He's on the road to Damascus, and he says that he has an appearance of Jesus Christ, and he converts to a follower of Jesus Christ. I mean, it'd be like Osama bin Laden saying, oh, you know, I was wrong, and he converts to Christianity. Or it'd be like the atheist regimes of Stalin, Pol Pot, Mao, Kim Jong-il, which murdered and brutally raped over 150 million people. That's how evil atheism is. It'd be like them saying, oh, I was wrong, and, you know, becoming a Christian. You know, Jesus would never be a guard at Auschwitz. Jesus would, never be a Stalin, Pol Pot, Mao. Jesus would never be as evil as those atheist regimes. But Paul was doing some pretty bad stuff. In fact, Paul was there when the first person died for Jesus Christ, the first martyr, Stephen. In fact, as they were taking off their coats to be able to throw these rocks and to stone Stephen, they laid them at the feet of Paul so he can kind of watch over them. So Paul even witnessed the first murder of the first martyr for Jesus Christ. And later on, Paul becomes radically changed by his conversion when he witnesses the risen Lord Jesus Christ. And here's what he says. He says, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. Now, I don't think it's foolishness, but that's good news. Notice he says it's foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. He says, where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? See, what mankind thinks is wise, you know, they're so into themselves and they think something is wise, but it's really foolish. For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For Jews request a sign. So the Jews are all into seeing signs, and Greeks were more of the intellectual, worldly people. Notice he says, Jews request a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. To the Jews a stumbling block, and to the Greeks foolishness. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. This is something that if you're a Christian, it's something that I know you and I were so grateful that we were called. Thank God we were called. But God has chosen the foolish things. That's you and I. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things, that's you and I, of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty, and the base things of the world, and the things which are despised, God has chosen, and the things which are not to bring to nothing the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. Notice, God gets all the glory, you and I don't. But of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness, and sanctification, and redemption. You know what? I like the way that sounds. Look what God has done for you and I. Isn't it epic? Righteousness, sanctification, redemption. That, as it is written, he who glories, let him glory in the Lord. This is called the Light of Christ Gospel. And then this is just beautiful. I mean, Paul writes in an epic fashion. He says, therefore, since we have this ministry as we have received mercy, we do not lose heart, but we have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So then death is working in us, but life in you. And since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believed, and therefore I spoke, we also believe, and therefore speak, knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus, notice, Paul's referring to Jesus' resurrection from the dead, will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that grace, having spread through the many, may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. Seeing the invisible. You see that? Therefore, we do not lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. And look what Paul says. See, this is wisdom, guys. This is wisdom. The world puts value and stock in things that you see with physical eyes that die. But Paul says, look at this, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things, look, which are not seen. Remember earlier when we were saying the wisdom of the world is foolishness? This is what Paul is saying here. For the things which are seen are what? Temporary. But the things which are not seen are eternal. If you can see it, it's not going to last. Remember, Jesus spoke again and again and again and again to store up your treasures in heaven where moth and dust cannot corrupt it. And he talks about the value of the soul and what can we give for our soul. This is wisdom, guys. Are you getting it? If you're not saved yet, this is wisdom. This is genius. This is Christianity. Now, he goes on to say, for we know that if our earthly house, he refers to the body as just a tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with our habitation which is from heaven. If indeed, having been clothed, we shall not be found naked, for we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, but further clothed, that mortality may be swallowed up by life. Notice, he's talking about when we pass on from this tent, our fleshly tent, it's swallowed up, mortality is swallowed up by life. In other words, you actually live. You're not dying, you're living. Remember they approached Jesus and they had a trick question and they talked about this woman that got married to like three or four or five different people through her lifetime, and they said, you know, since all her husbands died, who's she going to be married to, you know, in the resurrection? Because the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection, right? And Jesus basically said, look, you don't understand spiritual things. He said, God is not the God of the dead, but the God of the living, he told them. And he said that there is no marriage in heaven, and God is not the God of the dead. He's the God of the living. He said they're like angels in heaven. Now, Paul goes on to say that God who has prepared us for this very thing is God. Notice, now he who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who has also given us the Spirit as a guarantee. So we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. So there's lots of churches that I know of that do this, but there's a church over here in California that's close to me. I'm in California, that does this. And when you're a Christian and you're going to pass on and you're in the hospital and stuff, they'll go there and it's a celebration. They'll have music, and it's a beautiful thing as you pass on into life. And I think that would be a wonderful thing to do for Christians that are passing on. There's no mourning and, oh, this is so tragic and everything like that. There's atheist on YouTube, and he did a video about his dad that was an atheist that passed away. And he says, you know, in the video, he says, well, I thought I'd do a video about this because everybody loves tragedy. And that's what death is for the atheist. It is tragedy. But notice what Paul says. He says, so we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. So in other words, we're alive now in the flesh here, but we're absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, yes, well pleased, rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Notice, he's not saying, oh, it's a tragedy. Notice, he says, well pleased, rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Now, let us go to a passage that is, I would say, one of the most important passages in Scripture. Now, this is 1 Corinthians 15. And when biblical scholars study these letters and these documents, the writings, and they try to date them, a lot of them are saying that this dates right up to the cross. And what they're talking about is right here, 1 Corinthians 15:3-7. Now, let's go through this. I want you to go through this with me. And before we do, this is what's known as a creed, okay? A creed. And these creeds, because back then, you know, they don't have, I guess now it'd be similar to, let's say you were going to burn it on a DVD or you could put it on your MP3 player, your iPod. If you wanted to record something for memorization, you know, you would write it down. And a lot of people still do that now. If you obviously, if you want to memorize something, you'll write it down, and you can keep it with you in your wallet, and then keep reading it over and over, and you can memorize this. And a creed would be worded in a structure for memorization, and it would be taught to other people. And this is how people would teach scripture. And these guys that memorize these creeds, they were brilliant. They can memorize long passages and get it right 100% of the time. And so listen to this creed. It's really important. Notice it's talking about Christ dying and then rising again. So you'll hear people say, well, I mean, I don't know where these people get this. They'll say, well, they didn't start talking about Christ resurrecting until 100 years later or 40 years later. And they'll say all these things, and it's just not true. This creed, many biblical scholars believe it goes right up even to the cross and the resurrection. And a lot of people believe that Paul received this creed shortly after his conversion on the road to Damascus. So let's go through this. Paul talks about this, how he receives this creed from the early Christians. Why? Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which you stand, by which you are also, which also you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. Now go through this with me, please. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received. You see that? This is a creed here. It's a very early creed. So people can't say, oh, it was legend. This totally decimates the legend theory. It's over. This is proof and evidence. This is an early creed. It's not like the game of telephone where 100 years down the line someone got it wrong. This is a very early creed. And legendary theory takes a long time to develop, sort of like stories of Pecos Bill, Paul Bunyan, the Vanishing Hitchhiker, you know, these little legend theories. They take a long time to develop. This is very early on. So there's not enough time for legendary development to begin. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received. You see that? Here's the creed. That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas, or Cephas, you could pronounce it either way, then by the 12. After that, look, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom, look at, the greater part remain to the present. Most of them are still alive, but some have passed away. Look, but some have fallen asleep. In other words, he's saying, you can go talk to them. These are witnesses. And then here's something fascinating here. These are all gold nuggets for someone that's interested in biblical history. You notice this isn't reading like a fairy tale, like the fictional book The God Delusion by Richard Dawkins, or a story Hansel and Gretel or whatever. these people here really believed that Jesus died and rose from the dead. Even if you're an atheist, you would admit that. You have to. It's obviously true that this wasn't a conspiracy. They didn't all get together and say it so they could all be martyred, which happened to over 90% of them. They believed it. So what a rational person does is you say, well, what is the origin of their belief? And I have to tell you something before I finish. I was very pleased to be in a debate with an atheist recently, and I asked him this question. I said, if someone is willing to admit that God exists, is the most rational conclusion to why the disciples believe Jesus rose from the dead is that Jesus really did raise from the dead? And to my pleasure, it gives me hope for people that are in atheism. The guy was honest. He goes, yes. He goes, I'm willing to admit that if someone's willing to admit that God exists, then that is the more plausible reason why the disciples believe that Jesus died and rose from the dead. If you already are willing to admit that God exists, it is the more plausible, rational conclusion. We look at the origin of their belief, and I'm telling you, if I was a jury on the jury stand, I would have no doubt that the more rational conclusion, it can't be legendary theory, it can't be myth or fairy tale, these disciples really believed that Jesus died and rose from the dead, and we have to look at why did they believe it. They didn't just lie and make it all up just to die these horrible deaths. They really believed it. And like the atheist said in debate, he said, yes, if someone's willing to admit that God exists, then Jesus rising from the dead is the more plausible reason why the disciples believed it. So there you have it from the mouth of an atheist. He admitted it. Notice he says, after that, Jesus was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep. This is another gold nugget here, and evidence and proof shows that this is true. This part here where it says, after that he was seen by James, then by all the apostles. Do you know, most biblical scholars believe and agree that James was not a believer and follower of Christ in the beginning. He didn't really have this conviction and belief that Jesus was the Messiah. But later on, after the crucifixion, James comes to believe it, and he even is, Josephus even refers to James, the brother of Jesus. Josephus is extra biblical information. So you have the brother of James not really being a believer in the beginning. Now he believes. Something happened there too. You have Paul, who's an enemy of Jesus Christ, killing Christians, then he also believes. Something obviously happened. And if you're not bigoted, I shouldn't say you, but if someone, I don't want this to get personal, if someone's not a bigot or prejudiced or bigoted towards God, it flows nicely. Using Occam's razor, it is more rational, intelligent, wise conclusion. You know, I was listening to the Atheist Experience show, and one of my friends called up there and went through a lot of science and biology, and talked about how talked about abiogenesis and things like that. And even the Atheist Experience show said that it is possible that Jesus died and rose from the dead. So you have all this evidence pointing to that. Even atheists are saying that it is the plausible conclusion, given that God exists. Then look what Paul says here, that he also appeared to all the apostles. Then last of all, he was seen by me also, as by one born out of due time. Now, let's say that there's you and I, and we're apostles, right? But let's say we were lying. And under torture, don't you think some of the apostles would have broke and said, okay, it's a lie. None of them broke. They were all willing to die for it. Think about that. So this tells us that they did believe it. Nobody argues that. Even the atheists agree, yeah, you know, it's obvious that they really believed it. But that should worry you if you're an atheist. If you're an unbeliever in Jesus Christ, that should worry you that you're not willing to go where the evidence goes. Don't let your bias and bigotry against God hold you back from truth. Be a true free thinker. The hardest thing I ever did as an atheist was to step outside myself, my bigotry and prejudice against God, and to be a true free thinker. Then and only then will you arrive at truth. You've got to be willing to let go of all your presuppositional ideas, your naturalistic ideas, and you need to go where the evidence is. It don't matter if you don't like it, guys. You go where the evidence is, and this is why I left atheism to become a Christian. Atheism is a view of which there is no evidence. It is Christianity that has proof and evidence. Now, Paul then says, then last of all he was seen by me also as by one born out of due time. So, he talks about Christ being our hope, and he's basically saying, look, he's saying this isn't a game. This is real, this resurrection of Jesus Christ. And he makes really no bones about it. Look, he goes, now look, if Christ has preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? He's like, you got to quit saying that. Christ is raised from the dead. He says, but if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And he's saying it's either, it's black or white. Either he rose or he has not risen. And he says, and if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and your faith is also empty. Yes, we are found, and we are found false witnesses of God because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. You see what Paul's doing here? He's basically saying there's no wavering here. Either Jesus rose from the dead or he didn't. And of course, Paul's saying he did. He rose from the dead. And Paul goes on to say, look, for if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. So he goes on and he explains, look, there's no beating around the bush. If Christ rose from the dead, we need to preach it boldly. If he didn't rise from the dead, then we shouldn't preach it. And he's basically telling them, look, he did rise from the dead. Look, Paul goes on to say, look, but now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. You see that? He's referring to Adam that brought sin into this world. And then he's also referring to Jesus who puts himself in the tently flesh of man and brings the resurrection. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. So if you're not in Christ, by default, you're in Adam. And if you're in Christ, then you shall be made alive. But each one in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterwards those who are Christ that is coming. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father, and when he puts an end to all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he has put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be destroyed is death. For he has put all things under his feet. But when he says all things are put under him, it is evident that he who put all things under him is accepted. Now when all things are made subject to him, Then the Son himself will also be subject to him who put all things under him, that God may be all in all. So let's wrap it up here. He's going to talk about the effects of denying the resurrection. He says, otherwise, what will they do who are baptized for the dead if the dead do not rise at all? Why then are they baptized for the dead? And why do we stand in jeopardy every hour? It's like, you know, why are we risking our lives if something was a lie? Of course it's true, he's saying. He says, I affirm by the boasting in which I have in Christ our Lord, I die daily. If in the manner of men I have fought with beasts at Ephesus, what advantage is it to me if the dead do not rise? Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. Awake to righteousness and do not sin. For some do not have the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. But someone will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? Foolish one, what you sow is not made alive unless it dies. And what you sow, you do not sow that body that shall be, but mere grain, perhaps wheat or some other grain. But God gives it a body as he pleases, and to each seed its own body. All flesh is not the same flesh. But there is one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of animals, another of fish, and another of birds. But there are also celestial bodies and terrestrial bodies. But the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. There is one glory of the sun, another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars. For one star differs from another star in glory. So also is the resurrection of the dead. The body is sown in corruption, it is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body, and there is a spiritual body. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. Now let me ask you guys something. What is of more value, the natural body or the spiritual body? Well, we would all agree the spiritual body. If you have a car that is only going to last like 4 or 5 years, or you have another car that's basically serves you even better than the first car, but it lasts longer and it's more reliable, of course you're going to like the more reliable, lasting longer car, the better car. So we put value in things that are of more value. The natural is, remember what we said earlier in the passage, if you can see it, it's not going to last, right? The spiritual lasts forever. So the wise person is going to put value in the spiritual body. And Paul says, however, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, and afterward the spiritual. So you and I have the natural now, and after we're going to have the spiritual. The first man was of the earth, made of dust. The second man is of the Lord from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are made of dust. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are heavenly. And as we have been born the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly man. So Paul finishes up here. He's like, hey, you have nothing to worry about. Death cannot sting. He says, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Well, God bless you guys. Don't forget to go to shakanow.net. It's right below this video, and get all those free things I told you about. And, oh, don't forget to listen to my call into the Atheist Radio Show when they failed to provide proof and evidence that atheism was accurate and correct. Remember, it's not atheism, it's faithism.